हाँ है रितेश का, रितेश झा कर दिया था, बिहारी बना दिया था।
वी आर ऑन फेसबुक लाइव नाउ.
ओके
सो गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल आवर व्यूअर्स. नमस्ते. दिस इज सौरभ कौशल फ्रॉम स्मार्ट सर्किट्स इनोवेशन प्राइवेट लिमिटेड, योर होस्ट फॉर द डे अलोंग विद मिस्टर मिथुन दीक्षित, विल मॉडरेट द सेशन. सो टुडे वी हैव अ वेरी स्पेशल गेस्ट विद अस, मिस्टर रितेश शाह. Ritesh Shah ji is an Indian screenwriter. He has written the screenplay and dialogue for films like Kahani in 2012, Pink in 2016, Airlift in 2017, and Raid in 2018. He won the Filmfare Award, Star Screen Award, and Zee Cine Award in the Best Dialogue category for Pink. So welcome, Ritesh Shah sir, on our live interactive session.
Thank you, Saurabh. Hi, Mitul.
Hi, Ritesh. Good to see you. And thank you, Saurabh.
And on the other hand, we have Mr. Mitul Dikshit, who is the chairman of the Dikshant Group of Schools, as well as the director of Chandigarh Literature and Film Festival. So welcome, Mitul Dikshit, sir, on this live interactive session. So request you to please start with this session, Mr. Mitul Dikshit, sir.
Good to have you, Ritesh. Finally, you have come in the picture. And you are showing your face that you are writing a lot. So my first question is, how many scripts are you writing at this point of time?
It's an interesting question. It should be, how many scripts have you been offered and how were you emotionally drawn into saying yes? But the fact of the matter is, the reason for this look is not the writing, it's the lockdown itself and the sort of psychological whirlwinds it's creating in my mind. So honestly, I'm not able to write much. In fact, when things were open, people think ke to bahut ideal time hai writers ke liye, matlab ghar pe hi to hai likhega. But with the amount of things that are going in my mind and the amount of housework I have, because I'm de facto chef, gardener, dog walker, resident housekeeper, everything. So much of it is not happening, but I am having trouble with the mainstream stuff because it seems kind of frivolous at the time. So I'm not able to write that much. But things that I really like, things which are close to my heart or things which I wanted to talk about all along, that page, if I may say so it myself, is reading better than what it used to read 3 months before. Because I feel like perspective, aapko ek naya hi perspective ye COVID times mein mila hai. That is helping those sort of things. That when I look at the page, it seems much more earnest, much more honest, much more living compared to what it would have been probably 3 months back in certain subjects which I like.
Okay, so still you did not answer in numbers the number of screenplays officially, you know, which have been handed over to you, because last figure which I got to know was some 15, 20, 25 exaggerated numbers, which you are working on.
That's exaggerated. See, what happens is that films are in writing for a long time. I have always done two at one time and cross genres. That if I was writing a very sort of a typical heist film, I would, you know, marry it with writing a soft, meaningful subject, because when you are on the other one for a week, at one point there's saturation, so you can refresh yourself the next week on this and then you can switch. So I have always written two at a time. But what happens is that there are narrations, there are old films, there are films which I, there are some films which are still being talked about, which I've written probably 7 years back. And that's what tends to happen. So yeah, at a given time, easily in a month, I'll be probably narrating 4 or 6 scripts. And some I've been writing for years and rewriting them. So sometimes, I mean, the number could be as much as that, that in a month I would have actually reread, rewritten, started freshly. Some probably it could be as high as 6 in a month sometimes. But it has always been since 2012 before D-Day. Actually, after we finished, I remember I finished writing D-Day with Nikhil, Suresh and Niranjan in 2012, September. After that, it has usually, my output has been high because I also write dialogue, which a lot of my screenwriter friends or directors, they don't write Hindi dialogue. And because I have a long working relationship with them. Ideally, I like to do everything, but I am kind of coaxed into doing dialogue also. So that's why the output has been relatively high, and that's why this exaggerated number that the standard question I get asked everywhere when I go for a meeting is, "Kitni script hai likh raha tu?" And then the next question is, "Please, meri bhi kar do." So I mean, it's there's a weird thing in our industry. At one point you get offered nothing and you're twiddling your thumbs, and at another time you get offered everything and people really coax you. And sometimes they are friends, sometimes they are big stars. You have worked with them, you have worked with them for years. It's very difficult to say no. Anyway, I have trouble saying no. That's probably something I may not have learned even during COVID.
So coming back to the serious conversation. And tell me something about, you know, your growing up years. Where did you do your schooling from? Because what was your life before college?
Yeah. So I was a very careless, carefree child, and I grew up in one of the most beautiful places in the world, which is Kashmir. And I went in and all around because of my school, which is CMS Tyndale Biscoe School in Srinagar, which puts a lot of emphasis on extracurricular activities. In fact, the motto of the school is, "In all things, be men." So I can row a boat, I can climb a tree, I can climb a mountain, I can do a lot of other things which probably kids of my age can't. One, because I lived in Kashmir, and because of the school. Blissful as my childhood was, with picnics and fishing and boating and swimming and eating fruit straight off the tree. Generally, I was a sharp, careless fellow and also prone to mysticism, in the sense that I would bless or curse people, and that's the nature of the place because, you know, it's very spiritual in nature also. My great-grandfather was a saint and the whole atmosphere was like that. Then actually some rituals were performed to cut off my connections with the divinity and, you know, make me stick to the world. And that has unfortunately happened. You know, I'm a sort of not an atheist, but an agnostic, not very spiritual, sort of a charvaki kind of a guy I am, with some humanity thrown in. And it was, and as blissful as it was, and as everyone knows what happened in the latter part of my childhood, when I was around 13, just when I entered my teens. So Srinagar had a very sort of, even all of Kashmir, it burnt in this frenzy of this sort of a separatist ideology. And last 2 years were very bad, and eventually were forced out to move. And the moment I crossed the Jawahar Tunnel, and I had never been anywhere in my life before I turned 15. In fact, I thought the berth of a train was on the front of the engine. I didn't even know where a train berth was. And 15, the moment I crossed that tunnel, I became a very sort of a serious teenager. So I was a very angsty, quiet guy for 3 years, and I finished my schooling from Cambridge School, Delhi. So I was very inwards, although I continued, I went back to sports and stuff like that, but very inwards, very very shy, probably had a lot of rage inside, probably, you know, had developed communal feelings also. And it was the worst phase of my life, although I was still doing well in school, still doing very well. And then once I came to college, which was, I think we should probably stop here because college comes later, and probably wanted to know the kind of person I was before that. So 15 years, and then a direct contrast of 3 years in Delhi, which I think the first 3 years were very hard on us as a family and me as a person. But in a way, it must have brought out at least the sensitive side in me, which later helped me in writing. So this is probably a short sum up of my first 18 years of life.
So how did you land up at Delhi University? And because, you know, it's the same years we were at the same college, Hindu, 93-96.
Yeah.
And how did you land up at Hindu and join English Honours?
As I told you, I was a very good student, and after class 10, I mean, I actually had much, much better marks in science and maths, and I had done very well. In fact, my social studies marks were very poor, but I knew I was very good with language as well as social studies. I was interested in that. And those were times when really, you know, in order to get to crack IIT or AIMS or whatever. I think you needed tutorials or something like that. Financially, we were not doing very well as a family at the time. I thought it was just an additional burden and it was not something which I really used to like. I did have an attraction for medicine, but then I thought maybe I can serve in a different way. And arts was probably what I needed to do. So I did arts in Cambridge. I did very well. And I did well in spite of the psychological damage that was there. When I saw my results, I was sure that I would get into the top four colleges. So I actually never filled a form for anything except Stephens, KMC, Hansraj and Kirodimal. I was sure that I'll get into one of these four. And I didn't clear my interview in Stephens and I promptly walked across the road. And that was a college which actually set me up on this career. So it's just a stroke of luck and my interest in language and social studies as such, which brought me to literature in Hindu. Although there's a joke which one of the famous professors at Kirodimal, Professor Badri Raina, cracks on us, saying that every middle class, upper middle class child in a public school thinks he can do English literature.
So was it your choice of doing English honors?
Yes, my first and only choice. I have never filled a form for any other course or any other college apart from these four. I was very clear that I wanted to do literature.
Okay. And then from college, you went on to join, which year did you join Act One?
So 93, I joined college. I was already doing a little bit of theater all through school. Which is basically amateur school plays. In 93, when I joined Hindu, I immediately joined Parivartan, which was a street theater group. Although there were two or three more clubs, like there is Ibtida, which was set up by Imtiaz Ali sir, and there were a few more groups. But I joined Parivartan. I did street theatre with them for a year or so. The next year, Act One posted these bills throughout the university that they were looking for young talent to come and join them. Act One was a very thriving, successful theatre group for a long time in Delhi, where many stalwarts like Mr. Piyush Mishra, Mr. Manoj Vajpayee, Mr. Ashish Vidyarthi, and many, many more who have come from there. So I always was interested in Hindi theater. I knew that, possibly Hindi theater or cinema would be the medium of my expression, although I'm doing English literature. So when these bills came, we all went for an audition and it was not really an audition. It was a sort of an introduction. They said, we don't believe in testing people. We believe in working with them. And the training was so strenuous and hard that after 20 days or so, I actually ran. And usually you're not called back. They never wonder that why did this man disappear? But I was specifically called back. And then Mr. N.K. Sharma was one of the founders of the group and our director and friend, philosopher, guru, mentor for life who set me on this journey. One of the most influential people in my life apart from my teachers, parents and friends. So he called me and he said, I don't want to do acting and I'm being forced to act and I don't enjoy it. I want to do backstage. So he said, are you sure you have any idea of what backstage is? I said, no, not really. So he said, tum sitar bajane to nahi aaye tha na, isi duniya se judne aaye the. Now get into it and you will figure out what you eventually want to do. So I actually started as an amateur actor and then became an accidental playwright and then was fired mid play because of indiscipline and then actually learned what backstage is and realized that out of these three, I didn't want to do backstage. I didn't want to act. I wanted to do what I was indisciplined about, the writing. And then I got into the discipline of it and I was disciplined for years until latter part of Bombay hit that quality, which I kept for a good 15, 17 years.
And tell me something about, the first play that you wrote.
So I was acting in that play and Piyush Bhai, as we lovingly call him, Mr. Piyush Mishra, he had already left for Bombay and the play was incomplete. So I was doing the lead role in that play. So midway through the play, during the rehearsal, I just walked down, during a soliloquy. And after the soliloquy was over, I just stopped. So NK said, why did you stop? I said, yahi tak ki script thi, so that's it. So he said, oh, that means that, you know, it wasn't coming from within you. You were just mouthing somebody else's lines and you don't know where you are and what you're supposed to be doing. So I realized, baat to sahi hai. I mean, this is absurd. Why did I stop? I know where I am. So I walked back upstage, came downstage, finished that speech and continued from there. And I started interacting with my co-actors whose roles I knew what they were playing. And then they started talking back. And then while they were talking back, I started correcting them. Actually, aapke kehne ka matlab ye hai. Aapko ye nahi puchna chahiye. So then I realized that I'm just guiding the conversation. When the rehearsal ended at the end of the day, NK called me and he said, now you guided this conversation. Now just write it down and refine it. And that's how we are going to go forward. And that's how I actually became a playwright at 19.
And which year was this? Which year of college was this?
This was 94, our second year in college.
Okay.
That was the same.
Was Shujit also coming to Akron during that time?
Shujit had stopped coming. I think Shujit had already started working in... He had probably started working, I think.
Okay.
Because he's a few years senior to us, but he used to come and see plays. So I remember when I was a playwright and I used to sell the tickets at the box office, I remember Shujit coming and, you know, Shujita, as we call him, to, you know, check out. That's where I first met him, actually. He came to see a play which I had written. Okay. That was in 96. So I'm assuming that he had left by then.
Saurabh, you have some questions
before
I continue?
So, sir, also, we would like to know about your journey. I mean, how you got a first break, right? Ghosh sir, you know, gave you the break to write a dialogue in the home delivery in 2005.
Yes.
So, could you let us know more about that break, how you got the break? I mean, after moving from Delhi to Mumbai, you worked for a six years in the television industry also.
Yeah.
And after that, you got a break in 2005. Yeah.
So, I actually came to Bombay. I had come in between to do voiceovers, to get voiceovers done for a film that I had directed along with two of my students, one of whom is my wife now. So I had come to Bombay in between, but I had no inclination to shift permanently. The third time I actually came is because this 96 play that I'm talking about, there was a feeler sent by actors from here that probably Mr. Ram Gopal Verma would want to make a film on that. So I came down temporarily with that film script, tried to get in contact with the said actor who had sent the feeler and Mr. Verma, but that never happened. And I just kept on waiting and I went for a chance meeting to a television producer's house with my friend, just because I had nothing to do. So as usual, what happens with us writers is that even if you offer us a cup of tea, we're not going to be quietly sitting. We will end up talking. At the end of the meeting, the producer actually called me to his cabin and he said, we don't want to work with your friend, but we want to work with you. Which was such a moral dilemma, because when I stepped out and I told my friend that this is what he's saying, he says, "Arey, what is there? There's nothing ethical about it. At least you will earn and I can borrow money from you." So that's how I accidentally went into writing television, which was Kagar, although I had come to do film. But in May, I was signed by Mr. Trilok Malhotra for a film to be done by Mr. Kundan Shah. But for 6 years, all my films would either get shut down or the actors would get married or the producer would die. So much so that at one point I started leaving the house without telling my wife where I was going. And she was actually upset saying, do you think ab aapko meri nazar lagegi? And I said, no, that's not the point. I just don't know whether it's going to happen or not. So what do I talk about? So one more film which didn't happen, which I had co-written with Mr. Nikhil Advani, Maya. Even that didn't happen. And one of the assistants went to assist Mr. Sujoy Ghosh for home delivery. And they already had an English dialogue script and they wanted a Hindi dialogue writer. Milap had done some scenes, but then he had got busy with some other film. So they asked me and I actually auditioned by writing some 10 or 20 scenes in Hindi. And I was taken aboard 10 days before the film. But even after that, I was not very sure that this is going to start. So I took an auto from my house and went to Sun and Sand Hotel. And when I saw the reflectors and the lights and the camera, I was finally convinced that no, finally a shooting has started after 6 years. And that's there where I met my co-writer with whom I have written many, many films, Mr. Suresh Nair, whom I knew as a Bombay Times features editor. But as a writer, I met him for the first time. And one of the films that you mentioned, Airlift, that was probably our last release together, or maybe it was Chef. Actually, it was Chef. Airlift came in 16, Chef came in 17, I think.
That's great. So in the meantime, sir, we'll also take a few questions from our viewers.
Sure.
So I request all our viewers to please like and share this session. And if you have any questions, you can write down in the comment box and we will ask the question from Ritesh, sir. So we have a first question. You have been a part of the films like Namaste London, Kahani, D-Day, Airlift, among many others. In terms of satisfaction as a writer, would you rate Pink higher than all the films you have written so far?
In terms of the way I was projected and in terms of how much people have responded to the film, see, Airlift was also released in the same year and a very successful film. And I enjoy writing films like Airlift, D-Day a lot. Kahani, there was, of course, there was more Sujoyda's contribution than mine. Pink, in terms of how people have responded it to over the years, I mean, it's a film which has connected personally with a lot of people who have watched my other films also. And even till now over Instagram, or because all these films are on OTTs now and people are locked down. So Pink, especially among the women audience, it has had a great resonance. And also what happens at Rising Sun Films, which is Shrijit's and Ronnie's company, and Mr. Sheel Kumar also produces a lot with them. They have a thing for projecting writers. So projecting the writers, introducing them upfront, even to the press as the hero of their film and before even the principal stars. And the whole security that they have about their own craft, that they don't feel overshadowed by writers. So both in terms of projection, the way it was projected that this is the writer of the film, know him and appreciate him for what he has done. And also how the audience have emotionally reacted to the film. I mean, I remember I had come down for Mithil Chandigarh Lit Fest. So there were a lot of happy people, but there were a lot of unhappy men also who confronted me. So it draws people in. It's not passive viewing. And I've seen shows of film of Pink with the audience, and I've had, 13 or 14 girls at my back, talking back to the characters in the film, abusing the boys, abusing Mr. Piyush Mishra at times, reacting, talking, I mean, people talking to a film. So, yeah, I mean, it's an accident how you end up doing stuff like that, but it'll be rare. A film like that will rarely come into my life, I feel.
Definitely. But I think, Ritesh, for me personally, Pink was a film where the star of the film was the writer, that is you. I mean, that's something, because it's so well written. And I understand that what you're speaking about, Shujita giving credit to the writers. But in terms of this film, this seems to be, for me personally, and that's a personal comment, rather personal comment. You were the star for Pink, the way it was written, the way, everything, the characters fitted in. I mean, there were some actors who were perfect for, I mean, I don't know, how did you, I mean, did you keep...
See, I agree that the script is the plinth, the base. It is very important to have a good script, and it's very difficult. Rarely can you ruin a great script. But the thing is with Pink, it is, I know the writing comes across because, part of the film is contained. It's a courtroom drama. So there is a chance for the writer to really shine. But you must see that how all of these actors fitted their parts like a glove, and how their suggestions or their contributions. It also is not, he doesn't write physically, but he rehearsed with me and he would rehearse those court scenes with me. And Tony had brought the base already as the story. Then Ronnie remembering one particular line from one draft saying this must be done. In fact, 3 days three days after the shooting started, this no means no came into the film because, somebody had sent me a coffee mug with those words written. That speech wasn't even there and Mr. Bachchan didn't even want to deliver that speech in the end. But I said, let's try these 6 lines. So it was so collaborative that yes, they projected me because truly, yes, there was a lot of my own inner voice and experience in that film. There were a lot of moments of truth. But I mean, it is truly a collaborative medium. I know, because see, we try to project writers so much because there's a struggle for even his existence, you know, his projections, his name is not there on the poster, he's not promoted, he's not acknowledged, he's only acknowledged in closed door rooms. That's why this constant need for us writers and even people like Shrijit and Vipul and all these people to try and project the writer. But the fact of the matter is that it is truly a collaborative art. I mean, you can write a great script, but if you have a director who has no understanding of it, and if you have actors who don't know what they're doing, I mean, see, a writer is only as good as his teams. If you have seen some of my bad films, which I'm sure you've seen plenty, that's not just me alone. That's also people who have no idea of what they were doing.
No, I understand. But even with body of work where, you know, the number of successful films like Airlift, Namaste London, but there are three films which stand apart in terms of, you know, Raid was one of them. Of course, Pink was the first film where you got your due credit. Raid was another film, you know, where, I mean, the way the film was written, I mean, it was not an easy narrative to be a story to be, you know, to create that kind of a narrative.
Yeah, Raid was a very, very difficult screenplay to crack. And in fact, you know, even now during the lockdown, I'm getting calls from Raid of film industry people, directors like Ashutosh Gavarkar, who've seen it now, calling up saying that, how did you guys manage this? Again, as I said, we had a great crew. We had a great crew on Raid. And Raj, I have known ever since that fateful television show that I told you about. Raj came as one of the assistants on that show. So I have known him for a long time. So again, there is no insecurity in terms of what I'm giving to him. And we are very, very open, and the roles are not closed in terms of who's doing to what. And like Pink on Raid also, I was on the set for a long time. And I was rewriting and writing it constantly because we started that film very fast. So I had actually gone down to Lucknow and taken down the pictures of that Haveli and put them on a soft board, and then thinking about, you know,
I think Raid was the first film where you actually collaborated with Raj, besides, you know, the informal discussions. Yeah. And help. Yeah. So how difficult was it working with Raj? Because I saw him on the sets, and yeah, he was extremely, extremely shocked, and, you know, he didn't know what was happening, because, you know, he's one of those filmmakers who probably locks his film, locks his script, and that was his first instance, you know, where, you know, he just didn't know what is happening. Because, you know, with you, I think you're the most spontaneous writer that I've ever known.
No, we had three drafts before we started. We had three drafts, but you know how that he usually writes himself, in spite of the informal bits that we do together. So he will even have the shot of the doorbell in his mind. And this time, it just happened so suddenly. I actually thought they were kidding when I came back from IFA that we're starting shoot in September. But what I told him before starting shoot in Lucknow was that first 10 days, whatever we have, I'm very sure, let me go back and I'll come back with draft 4. So I was there, and only on the first day, I think for the first hour, he was frazzled. So he told everyone, just give me 10 minutes. And then he went to the van and took a break. Of course, he was hassled because we were writing and rewriting, and so were the assistants. Each time I would land in the Lucknow hotel, they would start running away in the corridor that aa gaya, schedule is going to shift. But if you see the certain humor, the things that we were able to do on the film, I don't think we could have done that with a locked script. Like, for example, when we found Dadi and the way we went bonkers about her, we actually have many more scenes of her, just shot as asides and things like that, because we were just writing, shooting. And it was typically like an act one play that you knew you had a core, but you were constantly rehearsing, re-rehearsing, sitting down in the hotel at night, rewriting. That happens in, that used to happen in Pink also. That has happened in Uddam also. I mean, nothing is sacrosanct. Definitely not what you have ended up writing and then said, oh, this is it. No, I mean, there are a lot of wonderful things which can happen. And Raj has worked with Anurag also, so I'm sure he could balance it out eventually. But yes, I did trouble him. And very difficult to work with friends also. That's
so your sound is... can you just...
Has it gone low?
Yeah.
Yeah, because earlier I was on that headphone and then the charge just stopped. So I'm putting it up. Is it sounding any better now?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm sorry about that.
No, sorry to interrupt you in that.
No, but it is such a collaborative art. I mean, nothing is sacred. Good things come out of getting hassled. Some good things came out, but we were like never again. I mean, we must be sure of, you know, what we have done before we ever go out.
Okay. And the third film I wanted to talk about was Bhatla House. So how was it, you know, how difficult was it writing the Bhatla House?
See, it's very, very difficult because there are three sets of people in this world. One set is convinced that the boys were innocent and even if God comes down, they're not going to change their opinion. Another section is convinced that the boys were guilty and even if God were to come down and say they were innocent, they would not agree. And there was a third set. So like, we have heard this name, but what was it about? So essentially, I wrote it for the third set. I tried to balance the first two sets and I had to be convinced of what I was writing about. I had to be convinced that, you know, eventually I'm not going to be unjust to anyone. And so it was the film that has been written over a period of 5 years, rewritten and written constantly. And the research and rewriting till, I mean, very, very difficult film to write and very, very difficult to do it in a commercial format. A big Independence Day release, we had a success on that day. To balance, you know, art and entertainment in that way, very, very difficult to write. I think eventually we got lucky with it and the audience kind of warmed up to it in spite of Mission Mangal being such a huge success and being in the theaters at the same time. I think again, whatever, if all these things, in all these things, if something has struck you, it has to have come from within. So what John ends up saying in the quote is something which has come from within, where he says, I wish that these boys were innocent, but in Raid, the moment what drives this officer, it comes from me having read that Namakka Daroga story in class 10, mm-hmm. having read these Dharam Yuga in India today stories about these customs of police officers, so constantly being transferred for being honest, or Pink, where observing and living in Delhi, seeing what is happening with the girls there. I think wherever, whichever a film of mine where some truth from either me or the director or anyone has crept into the film, however flawed it might be structurally or design-wise or this, that, if there is any moment of truth in that film, that film has always worked. Never has such a film, in spite of being flawed, worked in my career, which has had some amount of truth from my heart or somebody else's heart.
But how sensitive do you keep into consideration about, I mean, how sensitive the subject is and the
absolutely. And I always knew that we were going to have some trouble which we did not have with the censors, but eventually people went to court and they stopped the release of the film, and the film has cuts which were directed by the court in order for us to release. In fact, in the court scene there's a disclaimer which runs. So when we do films like that, you know that, you know, there is going to be a lot of resistance because it's very difficult to, you know, be able to speak the truth blatantly through cinema in this country. You can write a book, you can write a magazine article, but the moment there's a film, there are hundreds of people willing and waiting to go to court because it gets the attention also, which normally other things don't go. I mean, Anurag's film Black Friday, which was based on Black Friday, the book, its release was stalled for years, but what was in it which was more revealing than that was there in the book? It's just people fear cinema too much, I feel.
Saurabh?
Yeah. So, sir, as we're talking about the Pink movie, so we have another question from one of our viewers. So, he's writing, sir, you had written on your Facebook page that Pink is for your daughter when she grows up. So the script had a lot of heart in it. It had that emotional drive. So do you think that explained why the film seems to have connected with the audience?
Yeah, I think we partly answered that question before, and the listener might probably have been hearing it. See, when I said that I wrote it for my daughter, it meant for the world that she's going to step in. Already in India, you know, men and women are interacting a lot more at a younger age than they used to earlier. Women are working. So there is a traditional view taught, whether through peer group or parents or society, of judging a woman based on certain trivial habits, which might be just bad habits like smoking and drinking. But to judge that, to make that a judge of her character, and by character, we don't mean whether she's honest or kind to animals or whether she pays her taxes. In India, a woman's character seems to be about her sexuality or expression of it. So it was a very, very important film, and it was based on so many incidents which have happened to me, my friends, my girlfriend who's now my wife, or my other people, women I know, my cousins. So it combines a lot of their voices, and probably it has that power. I mean, in Delhi, I actually once hit a off-duty drunk cop in civils, not knowing he was a cop because he touched her inappropriately. So, I mean, probably it was not my business to be there in between, but, you know, men end up writing these films, men end up fighting these cases. So it was not just for her. I think it was for all our daughters, and it was for all our sons to just make them understand that, no, it's not like that. I mean, this is not just because a girl had a drink with you and was friendly or even touched you, was patting you. She has a right to her body. And if she does not want to have sex and she expresses that desire clearly by saying a no, that's where you stop. It's a simple, it's like the British. We tend to feel that we are backward. The British, the Swedish, everybody is grappling with the issue of consent. And the Brits made a very beautiful animated film around tea, because, you know, they love their tea, about consent. So Pink is actually a public service film. It's a propaganda film, actually, disguised as entertainment, because it's a propaganda film about consent.
So, sir, one more question is there regarding your movies. So, sir, question is that, was Amitabh Bachchan on your mind while you were writing the screenplay? Had Sujit sounded him out on the idea, or was Bachchan approached only after the script had taken shape?
See, what we had is, we had the script for a long time. We had about 7 drafts of it. And what Mr. Bachchan was pitched by, he briefed him, and I narrated the story to him in 5 minutes, and he said yes. But after he came in, because we had a cast now, and script was written as far back as April 2013, and it had been updated. The moment we realized he's in there, and now it's suddenly 2016, and so many things have happened in between, that we actually wrote about maybe 9 or 10 drafts more. And eventually what the film that you see is a result of those drafts. So before we started shooting and before we started rewriting, we knew he was going to be there. But the accusation that certain allowances have been made is because he's there in the film is completely untrue. What it gave us was a lot of courage, because, you know, he's a kind of an actor. When he says some things and does some things, there's a thin line between getting crass and between getting effective. So if you remember the Are You a Virgin scene, it was with us for a lot of time, but only a actor who's the grace of Mr. Bachchan, he would not cross the line in his performance. So yes, it does influence your writing, but not negatively. There is always a positive contribution of when you know who your cast is with.
There is another question which I saw, and somebody really wants to ask that question about, where did you get the idea for Raid? But I mean, I was fortunate to hear the first, the one-liner of, you know, raid the story. So about this income tax raid and you know, how it takes place. I mean, this single idea of, you know, I mean, how difficult it was to make a story, full-fledged story out of the whole film, for the film. And there was also an, I mean, it could have become a more of a docudrama kind of a film. So how did you?
As I told you, Mithil, is one of the most difficult commercial films that I've written, films which have found some commercial box office success. I mean, it's a 100 crore grosser for a film like that. I think it's great. I mean, we would have probably been happier if it had just crossed Drishyam, because this was also a very niche idea. So again, I said truth always works. So it's based on a real case tackled by this real income tax officer who is thanked in the opening credits. But that story didn't have the climax that we wanted. That comes from two more income tax officers who are also thanked in the opening credits. So 70% of that story comes from the central idea of this true raid. And the ending plug comes from the story of these two other customs officers, income tax officers, sorry. And because Raj has also done films which have had commercial success, but they're topical in nature. So here we had a big star. Here we had a story which was essentially a one-line idea, and 70-80% of the film is there in one house. So how to make that entertaining for that audience? How to give them the process of a raid, also explain the laws, how is a raid conducted? So to match it to... It was, as I told you, it was like this living piece we grappled with day in and day out, and eventually, until the final edit, managed to make something entertaining and successful for our audience. But I always tell Raj, I tell Ajay sir, that we got lucky, and they always say, don't be stupid, we worked so hard. But things should work eventually, and they worked.
And the idea of, does it scare you, the idea of raid 2?
Very, very scary. It has been scaring us for a long time. But this time we have time, as and when we are going to do it. So we have the luxury of time. And it is scary. It is difficult to match something very organic, because I told you, it was like a play. It was like a successful big play that we did in those 4 months. So it is scary. It's going to be difficult to, but it will be a challenge.
And it's quite challenging to pull it out, you know, the second time.
Yeah, even the first one was challenging, but this one is going to be very, very hard. I mean, because Raid has already showcased a lot of what happens. So how to go beyond this and yet be on the same subject, how to entertain more, how to get more drama, we could probably try and get in Ajay sir's core audience also to like it more. So it's going to be a tough ask, but if we crack it, then it's going to be super, I think.
So sir, we have one question from Praveen Kumari. She's saying, good evening. Sir, you are really a lucky person that you are getting name and fame, but usually why does it happen? When a movie has got a big hit, all the credits go to actor and actress or a director first, followed by the director. So could you please give a comment on this thing?
Yeah, hi, good evening. See, traditionally, ever since we started getting into talkies, and before the talkies, even in silent cinema, it is stars which brought people to the movie theater. I mean, the faces, if you see, there are picture postcards of even silent movie stars. So very early, the business became driven, the money at the ticket window, the people who were drawn to buy the ticket were drawn by the face. So when the biggest, therefore, also because they have box of office pull, you have seen the opening draw, it is drawn by a lot of stars because of conventional fans coming in to see them, regardless of what the story of the film is, regardless of who the writer is. But longer successes or bigger successes are script driven. Like say Bajrangi Bhaijaan is one of Mr. Salman Khan's most successful films, but it has a fantastic story too. So there, the number is much higher than it would be for a lesser successful Mr. Salman Khan film. Now, because of that, that largely people are interested. You cannot deny the fact that the reader or the viewer is interested mostly in the star or then the director, because they think cinema is a director's medium. While a lot of success directors have had is because of the writing also. So writers have not been able to project themselves well. Mr. Salim Javed, who had a massive run of success, they had 11 hits in a row, and they had the kind of personalities and personas to pitch themselves also in that manner. But the credit, because the press as well as the reader is interested more in the star, therefore they are projected and talked about more. It's as simple as that. If the readers would be interested in us writers, the press would interview us a lot more and give us a lot more credit, which they are doing, by the way. If you see that, unlike earlier, any new writer who gives a successful film is projected a bit more compared to what he was earlier. Also, what happens with the producers and other people, they think if we project these stars to these writers also as stars, tomorrow they'll also do things that the stars might do, ask for better pay, ask for better facilities, trouble us a lot more. They do praise you a lot behind closed doors, but they are unwilling to do it openly.
Yes. So, Mutul sir, do you have any questions, sir?
Yeah. So, do you have the luxury of luxury of having a writer's block?
No, actually, I was told I have other problems. I have writer's life. You know, writer's dog is sick. Writer's is not in good mental health. Writer's child is sick. Things like that. I don't have a writer's block because, you know, early days of acting writing with Act One, we have trained too hard. I mean, for a play, I've written thousands of pages. So I might write badly, but it's not that I won't be able to write. The getting to hit the keyboard, that is the block. Once you hit the keyboard and if you sit on a chair for 4 hours, at least one line is going to come. I have never had writer's block. I mean, I've written badly and then rejected and thrown it, but never have I said that I can't think. No, it's like breathing to me. I mean, thinking. I mean, right now, as I'm looking at you, something is happening here. I'm thinking about Mitul is cool, Chandigarh something, or what just Praveena Kumari asked. So it's like, how can you have writer's block when even when brushing you have an idea? So I have never had it. I've cracked things in the shower while brushing, while spilling milk on the floor. I haven't had that. What I have faced of late is writer's lag. Doubts about life in general and the world and worrying about things. I mean, when I go out at a grocery shop and people are begging for grocery, it's difficult to come back and write a cracking dialogue for a commercial film. It's not writer's block, it's writer's sensitivity. So writer's sensitivity is a problem, but block, I'm not trained. We are not allowed. We were trained to write at a traffic light. So I don't need isolation and things like that. We're not trained like that. When I first said I didn't bring scenes for the day once, and NK said, what happened? I said, no, people in hostel are too noisy all night, couldn't write. I'm going on the weekend to my local guardian's place and then I'll write in peace. And I still remember the lines he said. He said, tu kaun sa commercial writer hai jo James Hadley Chase ki novel churani hai jo tujhe 5-star mein likhwa hai. You write about life. You go and write what those noisy boys are doing in the night and I'll accept it. So I actually went and I sat in a mehfil writing for 3-4 hours and just absorbing what everybody is saying. And I actually wrote a college canteen sort of a scene, which was very nice. So wo sab mujhe nahi hota hai. Mujhe, main kho jata hu. I get lost into other things. But writing, hitting the keyboard might scare me, but once I hit the keyboard, then no block.
That was Ritesh's statement. It was a statement, more of a statement, not a question. And I wanted that to come from you because, you know, I said, you don't have the luxury of having a writer.
Yeah, that also.
For years, I've seen you, you know, and I don't see you giving any excuse, and probably you can write in traffic while, you know, traveling in the streets of Bombay and at all times. And the kind of, you know, the kind of work you have in hand is something which would not allow you to have a writer's.
Yeah, see, that luxury wasn't allowed in Act One also because we were doing a play every 3 months. Every day I was supposed to write and bring something. And then after doing television, you don't have luxuries of deadlines. You have to write every night. And then earlier film also, you're writing constantly. So I can write in a moving car also. And also it's like, it's exactly like table tennis. See, I've started writing ever since I was 19, not even 19, I was 18 and a half or something. And I've constantly written day in and day out. Sometimes I've written 80 pages a night. So that luxury, I can't afford it, and I never had it. We were not trained to say that there is a thing called writer's block. Yes, we are lazy sometimes. We are allowed to admit that I was being lazy, or I felt attracted by the cricket match, or some child playing in the park, or some dog making funny noises. But not out of being blocked. It's writing is tough, Mithil, because it's discipline. And discipline, we struggle with it. Most writers struggle with it. We're hypochondriac. We have a lot of other troubles. So the hitting the keyboard, the typewriter keyboard, is the tough bit. But uske baad nahin, block is sab to mila hi nahi kabhi.
But do you at times feel that when you're working on 5 or 6 films simultaneously, I mean, do you think that it's not one? Do you take one film at a time, or I mean, it's working simultaneously? And
as I said, 2 films I need to write simultaneously in a month. I'll be writing 2 weeks this and 2 weeks that, because one feeds off the other. I can't just write one film. I'm not as deep as Juhi is. We does not do step outlines and stuff like that. She's not into the mainstream kind of this thing. She absorbs and she feels everything. And I have not done films like that constantly. I mean, if a rom-com, I mean, how much depth do I possibly want to sink myself into? So I have done a lot of formatted cinema. So these formats have fed off each other. If I have to rewrite certain things or whatever, yes, it does become a bother. But I keep different days at least, or different weeks. It's very difficult to write 2 scripts in a day. You can't write morning one, night another. That's not possible, even for me.
So tell me something about Shaheed Udham Singh, the film, what you're doing.
Udham is not a biopic in the classic sense. It just marks the inward outward journey of this big revolutionary whose act of protest. So you know, with Shujit, how he makes his films are very different. So it's not a classical historical biopic jingoistic film that you would expect. It is the inner and outward journey of Shaheed Sardar Udham Singh Sanam. What would he think, for example? What was his life like? What were his acts driven by? What were his thoughts about violence? What was his friendship with Sardar Bhagat Singh? A lot of things. But at a Shujit Sarkar film. So there is no so-called Shujit Sarkar film, because each one is different from the other. But it's just so great collaborating with him and Shubhendu and Ronnie and Sheel and everybody on this film, and Vicky. It's going to be a special one, I feel. I mean, I think people who enjoy his kind of cinema will really enjoy it. It's a very, very interesting sort of his take on Sardar Udham Singh. This was incidentally the first film he ever wanted to make. So I said, okay, after 20 years, you're getting to make it. And, you know, I am eventually getting to work with you.
But while doing the research, did you go through a lot of literature and stuff?
Oh, lots. Shubhendu and his team in Shubhendu had already done it. I have like tons of messages from Sujit. There is a ton of paper right here in this cupboard next to me. So many books and so many historical documents and court cases and lot of material. It's like consuming so much paper and then giving out 110 pages. So yeah, that has happened a lot.
Okay. Saurabh?
Yeah. So sir, we have another question from Ruchika Sharma. She want to know if the movie does not go well, does it have the effect on the script writer too?
Emotionally, yes, but generally scriptwriter giving a flop is pardoned by the industry because usually he's not given the success also. So he's not burdened with the failure also. People usually think that the film is a hit because of them and not because of the writer. So the flop also they blame themselves on. They feel the writer has not made the mistake. We went wrong in guiding him because he has done successful films, sometimes with others, sometimes with us. Perhaps we could not guide him rightly. So failure affects the writer the least. Success does him a lot of good. It is not that damaging. A failure in our industry hits the director the most.
Okay. So we have another question from Jasbir Kaur. She wants to know, what are the various factors you need to keep in mind while writing, because the content is often criticized by different aspects of the society. So as a writer, it's your duty to represent something which is accepted. How you keep that in your mind?
See, belief is most important. After having done all your research, what do you truly believe to be true? If you believe it to be true, then say it. But don't say it like an abuse or don't say it in anger. Say it that it is going to hurt some people. How can you make the blow soft? So yes, account for their sensitivity, but don't lie for the sake of that sensitivity. Think of it that people come there to already like you. Otherwise, they will not have come. They buy a ticket, they are already saying this is a good film. That's why they have come. So they are already with you. Then once they are in, don't suck up to them, but don't talk down on them also. Just communicate your most true feeling. And you don't even have to practice that. Once you are convinced, one is coming from your heart, you don't have to guide your hand.
And so another question is that how much control do you have as a writer over your script once the shooting script is out? Does it varies from project to project depending upon who the star or the director is?
See, this I have said many a time. I've said we say many things about writers for other reasons, because yes, there is interference, and when it's bad, writers like to scream their guts out and it hurts all of us and we feel we should need more control. Writers don't need control. It's a collaborative medium. Writers need collaborators with a good knowledge quotient and an emotional quotient. That's all they need. Writers need good people. You don't need control. What will you do with control? That I want control over a bad line? No. You need somebody wise to saying, "Teri baki line hai achhi hai, line kharab hai, isko change karte hai." Or you can write it better. We know you're writing with this. That's not control. That's collaboration. It varies from project to project. Sometimes people are not interested at all in what I have to say. And they're like, "Ho gaya, aap mat aaiye." And there are some projects where I sit on the edit. I am shown subtitles also. In Rising Sun, writers look at the subtitles also. They're shown every card. They have control. With Raj on Raid, I have been given a lot of participative this thing. With Nishikant Kamath, I have always had that luxury. It varies from project to project, but I'm saying, who wants control? I'm not a dictator. I'm a writer. I don't want control over my material, but I want you to embellish it. I want you to reject things for the right reasons. I want you to understand it. I don't want you to reject something just because you don't understand it. Ask me what it means. Don't feel shy about it. Don't feel embarrassed. There are a lot of things I tell my own child that I don't know. Let me Google it. There is no shame in not knowing. There's no shame in giving away control. It's a collaborative medium. The actor says something, the writer, director says something. The only thing they should give to the writers, which I think Mr. Abhijat Joshi suggested, which is a very interesting thing. He says, "Aap problem batao writer ko, solution mat force karo."
Definitely. definitely. So, sir, here's one interesting question from a student. Rahul, he's saying, sir, Raid was very nice movie. Can you tell me who was the politician on which the movie revolved around, if you can?
A disclaimer which we put right in the film. The thing is, if you name individuals, any individual's relatives or the individual himself, if you are saying that it's a true story and is based on so and so, a person has a thing legally called right to character. Whatever is in the public and it is documented, you can show that, but you cannot say even a word about his personal life. Since what was happening in that house, we have talked about that in the film, it will simply be impossible for me to tell you the name of the politician.
Okay, Ritesh, if I was to ask you, I mean, the top three writers in the industry, who would be the top three writers you have maximum respect for, if you were to rate?
That's the most unfair question you could have asked me to get me into trouble with all my colleagues. Because fortunately, what has happened in the industry, at least from the time that I have come in, is writers are not jealous of each other at all. We are very, very collaborative and we are very, very supportive of each other. And you have to have a body of work. It's very difficult to name individuals in the present. Like, I came into this industry because of Anurag Kashyap and Sridhar Raghavan, who were both successful writers, but they recommended me saying, this boy is good, please take him. Similarly, I have recommended people, and similarly, there are colleagues who are very, very distinct. So I won't say I have favorite films, favorite writers, but among my contemporaries, I'll tell you that Juhi's October is my all-time favorite film, in the sense that it ranks in my viewing a film which has moved me immensely. So I won't say Juhi's all films and Juhi's my most favorite writer, but no, Juhi's October is one of my most favorite films currently in these days and times. I love Gaurav Solanki's Article 15. Similarly, I love a lot of films. I don't have favorites. I like certain films of certain writers, then I don't like certain films of theirs. Then there are not writers that I like, but Salim Javed are my sort of the divinity, the prophets. Then the trio, K. Balachandar, Malu Mahendru, a lot of people from the south. So many favorites.
And what about the upcoming and new writers?
I think Gaurav is very good. Gaurav Solanki is very good. Asim Arora is another brilliant writer whose work you should really look forward to. He's already done some very mainstream films like Bazaar and Malang, but he will astound you in the days to come. Rinne has just written her first film and surprised her, because I used to know her as a movie executive. I didn't know she would write something as nice as Thappad. Upcoming. So Saivin is definitely not upcoming now, and neither is Parvez. But these guys are doing some great work, and people are doing one film which have come recently, which is very, very well written. So I'm sure they'll also come up with many more films. Like Hitesh did one film, and then he just directed. And we were co-dialogue writers on a famous television show once. So Hitesh Kevalia, now he's a director, but fantastic writer also he is. There are a lot of people in Bangalore and in Kerala and in Chennai and other parts of Tamil Nadu and Telugu. That's also a space which you completely ignore. Some of those fantastic films are coming from that belt. So there's some fantastic writer-directors there also.
And what about, it's kind of repetitive, but what about the directors? I mean, not your favorite directors, but directors you would never say no to.
I think I'll hurt again a lot of people. See, I've loved collaborating with all of them, Nishi, Nikhil, this, that. But one guy who challenges me a lot is Shujit. So he's not my favorite director, but he's my most challenging director. I enjoy working with him on scripts and films and in life general also. So Shujit is somebody I don't think right now I would say no to somebody like him. But then it's very difficult. I have never said no to any of these guys either before. So it's not because of any other reason. But you see, I've done many films with Nikhil, Chujoy, Vipul, Raj, scripts at least. Nishikant, I even did a Marathi film, although I don't understand and speak Marathi that well. So whosoever I have worked with, I mean, rarely has there been somebody who has chosen not to work with me again. But I'm saying right now, Shujit is stimulating me the most, as Nikhil used to do at one point of time, or as Raj used to do, or Nishi used to do it initially. I had no visual sense. So he kind of provoked, because I had a theater backdrop. So I used to end up them writing them like plays. So there are many people who have contributed in their own ways to my growth. But the problem is, when you grow, you tend to outgrow some of them. So that's a problem. And you're not doing it for any other reason, but it's just that you want somebody more stimulating. I mean, I don't know whether I outdo my mentor, but at one point I felt probably, you know, in my mind, you do tend to outgrow the best of creators, and people have outgrown me also. So there's nothing to feel bad about. I mean, tomorrow I might outgrow Shujit also through his own contribution and then not enjoy working with him. It's not me. It's just that people change. And, I mean, any artist evolves, and then he wants the other challenger, the newer challenger. Some of these young guys, I mean, who are not even directors yet, I've already begun to like them more than the existing lot, because they're not. So it's just something which our training is to... We are actually told not to get attached to our directors or anybody, not even to our guru or our trainer. We were told that it's all history. The last Friday, the last play opening, it's gone. Like, I never collected posters of mine. I don't have any mementos from my plays. I have not preserved any of my scripts. We are not supposed to live that life. It's not for us. Favorites are not for us. The newer, the better is the favorite. The newer favorite. It's like my grandfather. He used to have a favorite grandchild every 3 years. The moment somebody would get some sort of sense, he used to just go on to the next baby. So I'm like my grandfather.
Yeah. And you always say that you don't want to, you have no interest in directing films. Is there any reason why you don't want to direct a film? I mean, you're happy writing, and of course...
I'm trained as a director, and initially when I had come down to Mumbai, it was to become a director, but I did not want to be an AD, because ADs were poorly paid and I used to earn okay enough as a playwright. I didn't want to sleep on the stairs and, you know, have a patakho ki dukaan in Diwali. So I thought I'll not take the assistant route. I'll take the writing route to direction, that I'll write and then I'll direct. While writing, I met so many people who I thought, ki, are, mujhe to kuch aata hi nahi, I just know how to write. This is what direction is. So I perpetually spend my life thinking I'm training myself more and more. What happened during that process is that I ended up writing a lot more. Then I also started observing that direction is not just the creative part. You are the captain of the ship. You have to handle people. Actually, some directors have called me recently during the lockdown and said, you direct. We will do that business. We won't let people know that it's not you who did all that stuff. We'll handle things for you quietly. But you come and direct something that you really, really want to direct. So one, I have not found something which I really, really want to direct yet, which I think they will not be able to do or somebody will not understand. And the second thing is that each of them possibly gave about a year and a half, 2 years of their lives to one story. Mine is buzzing with multiple ones. I barely give them 6 to 9 months. I can't give 2 years to a story. I'm very happy having 3 releases a year. I want to write a screenplay every 4 months. I want to, and also as an industry, you're suffering more on the writing front. We have 40 odd good directors, but we probably have only 20. I'm sure we have more, but we are not able to find them. So I feel that, you know, right now probably my services are required more as a writer. I can give our audiences more varied stories as a writer than I can possibly give as a director. Also, maybe I'm scared of failure, because, you know, directors, I told you, they're affected by failures a lot. You sometimes don't get to make the second or the third movie. But as writers, you are allowed, I mean, world over, the ratio for films, successful films, is probably 7 or 10%. Mine is at least 33%. So I do get a lot more chances.
Yes, sir. Yeah, I have one question from the viewer. So he's asking, sir, so many screenwriters claim to be inspired by the writing of Salim Javed, yet much of the writing cannot hold a candle to the work done in the 70s. Yeah. So could you please give a comment on that? Yeah.
See, there were a lot of actors that we idolize them, but as a single individual, that I idolize them, but I have not been able to match their work because I probably don't have the talent of both of them. Forget even one. Yeah. One, because they fed off each other. They were a formidable duo. Also, they had the luxury of some very, very intelligent filmmakers who would kind of allow them to have that grip on the script. So most of their successful films, although they have done a film with Chandar Bharat also as a newcomer, but most of their films are with top directors. Prakash Mehra, Yash Chopra, Ramesh Sippy, and then there were the two of them. Perhaps there was a thriving environment in which they flourished. It could also be true that although we say that they are our inspiration, but sometimes you're not as good as your inspiration. That guy might inspire you, but you cannot hold up a candle to him because you love just what he writes. You are not able to create something as good as what he has written.
So, sir, there is one question from class 7 student. He want to ask, sir, when a writer writes a horror movie, don't they get scared? Have you ever heard this from any of your fellow writer?
Yeah, I mean, it is known to happen that if you're writing something tragic, you can end up crying. I don't write horror that often, have never written, in fact. But it is possible that while thinking and researching and thinking of all these things all day, and writers write in the nights mostly, so any noise or any something strange that happens might scare them. I was writing in a hotel room once, the lights went off, as in the switch went physically off. And the rational mind said, okay, when I touch it, it will be hot and there will be a short circuit inside. That's why it has switched itself off. But the fact is the other lights in the room were on. And when I touched it, it was not warm at all. So it physically went off in front of my own eyes. But suppose if I was writing horror and this thing had happened, probably you would get scared. So yeah, you do tend to laugh when you're writing funny stuff. You do tend to cry when you write something very tragic because you're, you know, churning your own inner experiences. So possible to get scared while writing a horror film.
Yeah, definitely, sir. So one question is there, sir. Would you ever write a film such as science fiction? Or have any comments on a science fiction movies and all?
Yeah, I would want to. Probably that would be the next challenge. Both science fiction and horror would probably be the two challenges because I have written films, I have released films in all other genres. Not that I have not written. I have written a futuristic film, but nothing which has come out yet. So yeah, horror and science fiction would both be challenging.
Okay, last two questions. And one is, I don't know the sequence of it, but does it bother you at times, you know, the genre, the kind of works you are writing? I mean, I've often seen, you know, filmmakers, you know, trying to work out films on in different genres.
Just explain a bit more, Amitul.
My question is, I've often seen filmmakers, you know, bothering too much about, you know, the next film that they are working upon and the genres.
That's a trap. I mean, it's a trap unless you have a certain kind of personality and you can only do certain kind of stuff by nature. But genre is a trap. I mean, this Salim Javed question is very interesting because you could do a mixed genre and yet you could do a very, very entertaining film. And usually, you know, they tend to offer me political dramas more compared to any other stuff. But I think genre is a trap. All the films you have enjoyed as a child and as a viewer, you should not be genre bound. Ek woh thappa bhi lag jata aap pe and you don't grow. I mean, a movie is a movie. It can be any genre. It can be mixed genre. If we could crack something like what Salim Javed cracked in mixed genre, it would be good for all of us. Because it's not as if Diwar is an absurd film. It has huge content, but it's a heavily entertaining film.
In fact, I had forgotten my question. Sorry. I wanted to ask about the adaptations. One of the films was BA Pass, which was adapted. And
literary text.
Is there any other adaptation, and how difficult it is to write an adaptation?
Adaptations are very difficult, literary adaptations, because you're always confused what to keep and what not to keep. And film adaptations are conflicting because they bought the property and then they want to change it. My thing is, why do you want to change it when you bought it? What did you buy it for? And if you do a good job of it, people say, what is the big deal? It was an existing film. If you do a bad job, he's saying, here, he's ruining a bad film. So I do adaptations, you know, just to quote Irshad Kamil, ki kuch to mohabbat ke chakkar mein lut gaye, kuch daulat ke chakkar mein lut gaye. Otherwise, I would not have done literary adaptations, yes, but movie adaptations I've only done because of friendship. There is no other reason. Or earlier in my career, because of money.
So my last question to you, Ritesh, because I can see that, you know, I'm feeling guilty that this time, you know, could have been spent writing something or writing a film. Or
no, it's I'm not time wasted. Look at
the kind of work you are stuck up with. I mean, you have.
But these things are contributory. Look at this class 7 kids suggestion. It seems like a movie idea that there's a writer who has never written horror, starts to write horror and starts getting scared. Nothing goes waste for a writer.
So my last question on behalf of Raj. So how is Black Tiger proceeding, and how excited are you about? Raj is not going to watch this. I can tell you, you know, because I've been trying to get him, and every time I message him and I don't get a reply from him. He'll make a video call.
Black Tiger is something I worked on in one certain fashion, and now because it comes from him, I think he should take it forward from here. Because as I said, that, you know, I have to had say no to a lot of stuff on giving, you know, advances back and things like that. Because during this time, I have also taken a step back because, you know, I can't write that much anyway. And I'm always available to him as a friend and a collaborator. But I'm just, in fact, my this attachments were not working. So, in fact, I'm going to send it to him for him to work on it now.
Yeah. So, sir, I have last two questions from you, from the viewer side. So, one is that, sir, what are some recent films you watched whose screenplays you admired?
I'm very bad with names, unfortunately. Ayappan Kosham is one film I saw recently. It's by written and directed by Sachi. It was very good. Then this Dhanush's film, which was about these it's a gangster drama. It's a Dhanush film. I enjoy a lot of other Tamil films. I Am Prakashan is a Malayalam film I saw, which was very nice. Article 15 was lovely. A lot of the films were nice.
Okay, and so the last question is that how difficult for an ordinary person or a writer to step into a Bollywood, and any advice to aspiring writers in Bollywood from your side?
It is very difficult. I mean, it's a demand supply issue with Bollywood. I mean, acting is the most difficult break to get in than direction. Writing is also pretty difficult to get a break because, you know, because of the risk and money involved, and because of relations, and because the writer has such close personal access to people, they don't just let a new person in easily. So it is very difficult. I'm not going to joke about it. It is very difficult for a new writer to break in. Even when I recommend new writers, people want me to mentor them or be responsible, because very few people understand writing or can read a script. Even when me or Savin or Juhi or somebody else gets offered work, we don't get offered work because they understand our work. Most, many people just offer us things because they think that these guys have cracked the formula. They have a formula. They can't even probably tell whether we have written well or not. So for a new person, because it's a risk investment based there is sufficient risk of money involved, they would want to go with trusted names. But there is opportunity. There's a lot of opportunity now as writers' rooms. There is a lot of vacancy in writers' rooms because we are developing a lot of OTT content. So writers are required. Now there are more institutes. People have come in from SIMBI. People have come in from FTI. People have come out from universities abroad. So there is opportunity. It is difficult. But if you are good, I mean, one gets to know by simply watching the kind of movies that are in the theaters or the kind of content that is there on OTT. You will know if you are good. And if you are good, it might take time, but you will find your way. As far as advice is concerned, I mean, I have to advise myself all the time. So what advice can I offer a new writer? Except that there is no trick to it. There are a lot of screenwriting books. Some of them are very good. You know, if you read Robert McKee or William J. Acker or William Goldman, there are good books available. You can Google it. There's a lot more information available compared to what was available to us as writers. There are screenwriting courses and masterclasses offered over the net. There are existing screenplays you can take a look at. But eventually write. Don't be in the wait that when the masterpiece idea will strike me, then I'll write. Good, bad, ugly, write. Try to write every day. Try to write as much as you write. Try to make good out of a bad opportunity also. Okay, chalo, I'm not getting a great break. This is not a great break. But let me write something in it which is great, which somebody can spot and, you know, identify that this was good. Let me get this guy. Although overall it was bad. Then, or if you don't really need the money, you're not writing for a living, then I suggest you do something which Duet suggested to new writers. She says that go into it deep and only give it when you are convinced that this was it.
Thank you. Yeah.
A quick comment on that, because what I talked about, the tiger, I mean, I found it, I read it and I found it brilliant. It's just that the last part I really want to, that's a personal thing, of course. I mean, that I wanted to read your take on that and finishing off. Besides that, of course, let's. When did you last take a break?
I think that dengue was my break. September, that was the break. So September to about November was a sort of a break. And this COVID, March to this is also a sort of a break. So I think, but it came after 4 years. So 6 months in a year now, not out of choice. Once it was the mosquito and now it's the virus. But in the dengue phase, at least I was able to read a lot, reflect a lot. This one is I'm grappling with myself, let's put it very honestly. Because it's not a great time for any person with any amount of sensitivity. Plus, we have the cyclone threat also. So, yeah, this is a sort of a break.
So, I mean, your breaks only come out of, you know, being sick and or probably suffering from something.
Yeah, because if you're healthy, then what does a healthy individual do? A healthy individual contributes, and writing is my contribution. You know, I do very other little social work. I'm not useful to any of you guys in any way, except in the words. So, to quote that famous song, words are all I have. So there is no question of a break. And writing is not hurting. It's not troublesome. It's not household chores. I mean, it's a break in itself. But you should have the mind, the body should be healthy to do it.
Okay. Thanks, Ritesh. Lovely conversing with you. And there's so many things, you know, I really got to know. And I'm so happy about the kind of work which you are doing and the kind of work you have, the kind of, you know, writing you are doing, the kind of recognition you are getting. So it makes all of us happy, and keep writing and keep entertaining.
Thank you. That's what I do. That's all I want to do.
Yeah. So thank you very much, Ritesh sir.
Thank you, Saurabh. Thank you, too. Thank you, all the viewers.
The good thank time. You. And thank you, Mitul, sir. Okay, thank you very much to all our viewers for this session. So thank you very much to everyone.
I'm being Saurabh, okay?
Yeah, sure. Thank you, sir. सो थैंक यू वेरी मच टू ऑल आवर व्यूअर्स. शुक्रिया हमारे सभी व्यूअर्स को हमारा लाइव इंटरेक्टिव सेशन जो सीरीज ऑफ सेशन स्मार्ट सर्किट्स इनोवेशन प्राइवेट लिमिटेड की तरफ से चल रहा है. एंड थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर योर काइंड सपोर्ट एंड फॉर आस्किंग अ लॉट ऑफ क्वेश्चंस फ्रॉम द एक्सपर्ट्स एवरी डे. थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर द सेम फॉर योर काइंड सपोर्ट योर लव एंड ब्लेसिंग्स. एंड देयर इज वन स्मॉल अनाउंसमेंट फ्रॉम स्मार्ट सर्किट्स इनोवेशन प्राइवेट लिमिटेड साइड. We are coming up with a webinar on a 3D printing and designing on 10th of June, that is Wednesday. So if you are interested to be the part of that 3D designing and printing webinar, you can register for the same. We have a very limited seats. And इस webinar के अंदर आपको 3D designing और printing के बारे में सिखाया जाएगा कि how you can do designing with the help of a software. And our expert will teach you, and you will also get an e-certificate after the completion of that webinar. So please join. We have a limited seats for the same, or if you are interested, you can enroll today for the same, for the 3D designing and the painting. And there is one more announcement, as we are getting a lot of, queries or a response from our students and our parents for something related to astronomy. So I am really happy to share with you all that we are soon coming up with the asteroid hunting competition for you students. हम बहुत ही जल्दी asteroid hunting, जो asteroid space में होते हैं उसकी hunting कैसे करते हैं, उसको find out कैसे करते हैं, उसके ऊपर एक बहुत ही जल्दी competition और एक course लेके आने वाले हैं. So that कि आप खुद के asteroid space में search out कर सकते हैं. And once you will search out the asteroid in space, और अगर आपने वो रियली में सर्च आउट किया एंड आर टीम विल रिव्यू विद द इंटरनेशनल एक्सपर्ट, तो उस एस्टेरॉयड के नाम के ऊपर ही जो आपका नाम है उसी एस्टेरॉयड का नाम रखा जाएगा. इट्स अ ग्रेट अचीवमेंट फॉर एनी स्टूडेंट और एनी यंगस्टर. सो आप हमारी जो भी अपडेट्स हैं उसको देखते रहिए, और सून वी विल कम अप विद द एस्टेरॉयड हंटिंग एस्ट्रोनॉमी कॉम्पिटिशन फॉर यू ऑल, जिसके अंदर कोई भी बच्चा पार्टिसिपेट कर सकते हैं. एंड वी विल ऑल्सो लेट यू नो द प्रोसेस की हाउ टू हंट द एस्टेरॉयड फ्रॉम स्पेस. So we'll soon coming up with the space technology and the 3D printing technology. We have a webinar on 10th of June, Wednesday. So if you are interested, you can write down to us or you can talk with our team member at any time. आप हमें लिख सकते हैं, because we have a very limited seats. और उस webinar के अंदर आप software की help से ये भी सीखने वाले हैं कि how to design something 3D print with the help of a 3D printing. आपको software के through सिखाया भी जाएगा उसके अंदर, and you will also get the certificate. And in addition to that, बहुत सारे बच्चों की अभी भी हमारे पास queries आ रही है robotics को लेकर, and we have already sent a robotic kits to the students, those who have registered with us, and we have already going to start a new batches in the coming week. So if you are still interested in robotics basics or robotics advanced course में अगर आप interested हैं, you can join our demo. आप हमारा demo join कर सकते हैं. You can write down to our team member. But if you are seriously interested only, then you can join the demonstration part. Because in the demonstration part, we will let you know about what exactly is the robotics online course, how you are going to implement that course, what type of a kits you will get at your home, aur aapko kya kya padhaya jayega robotics ke andar. Each and every detail we will share with you in a demonstration session. And this is the right time to learn something new. Ek naya skill set seekhne ka ek bahut hi sunahara aur sahi mauka hai. And if you want to learn something in the field of robotics, you can write down to our team at any time. We will schedule a demonstration for you. If you are interested in space technology, if you are interested in electronics and communication or sensor technology, you can write down to our team, or you can book a free trial and we will give a free trial to you. But again, if you are really serious candidate for the same, only then you can apply for a demonstration session, and we will give you the free demonstration. And we are always here for you, and we really want you students can also do a lot of innovation in this period, and our team and our company will definitely help you a lot in this lockdown period, and we can always support you. So at last, I just want to say, if you are interested in the 3D printing and designing webinar, go ahead and book your seat for the same. We have a very limited seats for the webinar. And we are soon coming up with the asteroid hunting competition, जो एक बहुत ही unique competition होने वाला है, बहुत ही एक अच्छे level पर competition होने वाला है. And for that again, we have a limited seats for the asteroid hunting competition, and we will share all the details with you soon. So हम पेज को लाइक करते रहिए, सब्सक्राइब कीजिए, अपने फ्रेंड्स के साथ शेयर कीजिए. और इफ यू हैव एनी वीडियो रिलेटेड टू योर इनोवेशन, यू कैन सेंड टू अस. आप हमें अपनी वीडियोस भेज सकते हैं. अगर आपने कुछ भी नई इनोवेशन की है, या हमारी किट्स की हेल्प से इनोवेशन की है, कुछ भी आपने नया किया है, वेदर विद द हेल्प ऑफ अ स्टीम किट और अ रोबोटिक किट और इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स किट, यू कैन सेंड अस अ वीडियो. वी विल शेयर द वीडियो ऑन आर स्मार्ट सर्किट्स इनोवेशन पेज एज वेल एज ऑन आवर वेबसाइट, सो दैट द पूरा वर्ल्ड आपकी उस इनोवेशन को देखे. एंड If you are interested to be the part of our live interactive session, अगर आप हमारे session पर आना चाहते हैं और अपनी innovation के बारे में बताना चाहते हैं, if you have done a really great job in the field of innovation, you can write to us also and you can comment on our page. We will invite you on our page for a live interactive session and we will share your story with the world. So thank you very much for being with us and हमें इतना प्यार और love देने के लिए और इतना support करने के लिए. Tomorrow evening at 6 p.m. we have a session with STEM educator, we have a session with the principals. And tomorrow we are going to discuss about the digital online education. We are going to discuss about the post-COVID situation in schools. Ki COVID ke baad ki schools mein kya situation hone wali hai? Schools open honge to wo kaise open honge? Kya scenario hoga schools ke andar opening ke baad? Aapki padhai kaise hogi? And we will also discuss about the innovation. Ki aap ghar baith kar innovation kaise kar sakte hain? So stay connected with us. And tomorrow we have very innovative or very unique session about all these things. And if you have any questions, you can write down the questions in the comment box, or you can also inbox us. So till then, stay safe, stay at home. Apne aap ko surakshit rakhiye from COVID-19. Apni family ko surakshit rakhiye. Thank you very much. May God bless you all. Take care. Bye.